Welcome back to PGL Spring Tavern Tales. This is the second day of the event. We are going This is the third match that we're having today from 8 total, with me sitting Raven and Powder, who just, well, he just won a game, right? So I'm sure you're happy about the outcome of what was happening, but now you'll be joining us here and casting the game. So what can you tell me about the event itself? Like, are you happy with how it goes?
I mean, of course. Everyone here is super nice and very catering to all the players, and the whole venue is super amazing. And yeah, I mean, you guys can't really see what's behind the scenes, but everything here is fantastic, and it's been going well in the Hearthstone as well, so I'm happy.
Yeah, winning also helps, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm
also
sure.
Also a nice bonus there.
Yeah, exactly. It's good to have a guy on the couch that actually won, right?
Yeah.
He's like upbeat, you know?
Yeah.
But now we will have another two guys that will be battling against each other, and that will be Moody versus Kenny Leet. And I'm sure we'll have a lot of South Park references during the casting, you know? Especially if Kenny will get eliminated or something like that.
Right? I was interested what word you were going to use there, like so eliminated.
That will be a match versus the Romanian Pride of here that is, I think, a sole representation of the Romanian community in the
tournament, there's
right?
One more left.
Is it?
I think so. I'm not going to try to pronounce his name, but he's going to play a seventh game, I think.
Okay.
I'm not 100% sure, but I'm 99.
So here we have Romania versus Austria. Kenny's coming from Austria, and it's a new face on the block. This is the first time we'll actually see him broadcasted, right?
Yeah, and what's interesting, I was speaking to some of the players just before this match, actually, and from what I've been told, Kenny brought a really interesting deck yesterday. Mm-hmm. We'll see if he's bringing it again, but it performed very well. I think he 3-0'd three times with this deck.
Oh, really?
So yeah, I'm not going to, you know, like discuss it too much. We'll see if he plays it, and if he doesn't play, we'll talk about it afterwards, but I hope he does.
It might even be a hunter. No, wait, it's going to be a hunter because there were
six
zeros.
In a hunter at the end.
Mad. Yeah.
Well, the guys could change decks, right?
Yeah,
so
but
there's a chance.
If he already made like a 2-3-0s that meant he was playing it yesterday, and yesterday
yeah,
was
yeah,
the hunters,
true,
right?
True.
At all. Anyway, let's just cut to the videos with the players, some short interviews to, you know, get to know the guys.
So, I'm Stefan Marinescu from Romania. My in-game name is Moody. I'm playing Hearthstone from October 2013. I played several DreamHacks, several major tournaments, but so far I didn't win anything big yet. So I hope this is my chance.
Hello, I'm Kenny Leet. I'm 22 years old. I'm from Austria. I'm an IT technician. I working currently, and yeah, as a hobby, I play Hearthstone and try to improve and get popular.
I'm really excited for the new format. I think removing some cards will be a lot healthier for Hearthstone, and I'm really excited about deck building and all the new possibilities. And of course, I'm really hyped for the new extension.
I was a little bit orientated on the matchups from the qualifier because I also faced their secret powers, Reno Warlocks or Sue Warlocks, Warriors, Patrons most of the time. And I thought, okay, that's the most, the best decks in general. I tried to counter it with the pre.
Before a big event, I just study what will be the most what decks will be the most played, and then I will think if I want to play them and try to tweak them to make them a little bit better, or I want to counter them. In this particular event, I played two of the best decks, and the third deck I played my warrior because I wanted to counter my weak matchups. So warrior was my backup plan.
So we get to know something more about the players. I was really hoping that Kenny would show up in an orange hoodie, but unfortunately that didn't happen. That would be such a meme.
He's wearing a cool hat though.
Yeah, well, now we can see the hat actually on screen too. What are your predictions, guys? Because we will have some predictions from Twitch chat, from Twitter, from Gossip Gamers, but what are your predictions here?
Yeah, for me personally, it's a tough one because I don't know either of these players very well. We saw Moody play yesterday. You had a lovely experience of that on stream. But from what I've heard of Kenny's performance yesterday, I'm leaning towards him, to be honest. I'm excited to see what he can do.
Well, you told me that he made a 3-0 twice with the same deck. That means the deck is finds a place in the metagame, right? And that's always very powerful to have that weapon in his arsenal. So I'm really, really, really want to see that deck being an opener, because now we'll see if Moody actually prepared against Kenny, right? Did he do the scouting? Does he know that what kind of deck is the main weapon for Kenny, and will he counter that, right?
I think this is going to be a long series. I've never played against Kenny. I played against Moody yesterday for the first time. I think he's a pretty good player. It's hard to say, like Raven said. It just depends on what people think. It's always that mind games when you know who you're playing against. And at least Kenny knew exactly what Moody was playing yesterday. Mm-hmm. If he maybe countered that and hoped he was going to play exactly the same decks, it's so hard to say. So I think I'm going to keep it on the DL. With my prediction, who's going to win.
Okay, so basically, Pal's going to wait till the match is over and go in and do it.
Yes. Yeah, I knew it all.
I didn't want to say anything before the match, but yeah, you know, got it right.
Okay. Well, we'll see. We'll have to see. I mean, this is the third time, if I remember correctly, I see Moody in Bucharest at a DreamHack being qualified. From the open part of the open portion of the tournament, and it's cool to see him being consistent, but he always, as he said, he always lacks something to just be on the top. As you can see, Twitch chat is behind him, 58-42, which is not a huge margin. Looks like a typical
Twitter support,
typical Hearthstone win ratio, right? Yeah. I would say, but the Twitter is just mind-blowing. 10-90%, that's like, we have to guess that Moody has no presence in Twitter at all, right?
and also, looking at the Gosi gamers, they've basically took Powder's route and gone, well, you know, anyone could win, and we'll decide that afterwards.
Yep. Are they lazy then?
But kind of cool as well, so we just got a quick glance at the classes the guys are going to pick, and Kenny's brought a priest, which was the class that he was 3-0-ing with.
So, with the priest?
Yeah, with the priest. So I think, I don't know if you played him.
I didn't play him.
No, but so a few of the other guys did, obviously. But the priest was the one that caused all the fear. Okay. So that'll be really cool if we see this list again and see if it continues to perform after maybe the players have a bit more knowledge about it. Because I very much doubt that Moody was unaware of how Kenny performed with this priest, knowing that he was going to face him today.
Yeah, I was talking to one of Moody's Romanian friends outside just before we came and casted, and Moody was expecting that he was going to bring Priest. So I think he has some ace up his sleeve against it, and we'll see. Maybe it can still do well, but Priest is a little bit sketchy, I think.
Well, it's very narrow-minded, right?
It is.
It's either a counter to a specific type of a deck, or it's just being blown out of the water by aggro-ish type of decks that are just going to abuse bad draws from Priest, right?
Yeah, and this is interesting. I think Moody's classes might actually just be wrong on screen, because I'm pretty sure this isn't a Warrior Paladin or Druid at hand. So we'll get to that, but it is going to be Mage from Moody, which actually versus the Priest could be potentially very powerful.
Yep.
Well, that depends. The Deathlord might actually work both ways, right?
Yeah, it's actually one of the best cards against Freeze Mage, just because there is that chance you get out Alexstrasza or one of those minions that you really need, like Emperor actually does it.
Well, if you can kill it instantly, right?
Yeah, same with the Antonidas, right? If Antonidas comes out and then you have Shadow of Death, then that card, which is pretty key, is just removed from the game.
I don't know if actually Alexstrasza is not more important than Antonidas in this matchup, right?
Yeah.
Because which would kind of sound ironic, but Priest is not the best class at healing in the game, right? It has the arsenal, but usually you don't fit everything into your deck at the same time. So an example class like Paladin has a lay on hands, right? Warrior has shield block, which functions as a cycle and a heal at the same time, but Priest needs to rely on cards that have only a single purpose, like Flash Heal, that is only a heal or a damage card when you have a combo of Alcanai, but other cards that are the best in game about healing, they have a second function, yeah. Right?
Yeah, I mean, you would think that Priest would actually be really good because you could heal after the Alexstrasza, mm-hmm. but Freeze Mage plays so much burst that you don't really have time to heal that much.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing with Warrior, you can heal before Alexstrasza with the
you can build up the advantage.
Yeah, exactly.
But looking at the opening hands here, I mean, Moody's looking like he's got a pretty good opener. You always want to see those Mad Scientists early in pretty much any matchup because you'd rather them pull the secrets straight out of your deck. And even, you know, the Loot Hoarder to draw. Actually, already having Doomsayer Frost Nova is pretty big as well because Priest doesn't really have a lot of answers to that combo.
Well, there's Shadow Ward Pain, right? Some people are still playing it. I mean, we had a huge decline in popularity of that card because of the people tried to play a lot of four attack minions, right? Just to play around those cards. But I see people are playing Priest a lot. They're putting one Shadow Ward Pain at least because the meta is so aggro.
Yeah.
Right?
And it's also like with the new cards of Priest with like Flash Heal and stuff, you kind of had to cut something.
Mm-hmm.
And Shadow Ward Pain was one of those cards that kind of got thrown out of the meta for a while. But we'll see. He might be playing it. You never know.
Oh, he's actually killing the Mad Scientist. That's interesting because when you have the Alcanai Soul Prison already in hand and a Zombie Chow on board, you can abuse the Zombie Chow by just having it on board right now, because if he attacks the Mad Scientist, I'm almost sure that it will get pinged unless the mage is having a Arcane Intellect in hand. That's basically it, right?
Yeah, because the thing is, what you do is like you make the Zombie Child, like, you know, Mage isn't going to Frostball that, because the way you're viewing that minion is, oh, it's a heal that's going to come later on, so it's cool. But as you said, if you can like drop the Soul Priest and then gain extra 5 damage, that's really, really interesting because it provides a sort of bit of unexpected burst damage. And against Freeze Mage, if you can actually put them on the back foot, their plays aren't quite as proactive in terms of drawing cards. They might need to feel like they need to play a little bit more defensive.
Mm-hmm. And I like always to leave the Mad Scientist on the board if it's not like killing my own minion, because there's a chance that your opponent already has multiple secrets in hand and he can draw the secret during his turn, so he will be practically tucked by the probability of drawing another secret, right?
Exactly.
I think the only thought might have been the potential of Coin Fireball. Like that might have been the only reason to think about trading.
Would you do that? Because I think as a
Freeze Mage, I don't think so.
Yeah, it's a tough one. Maybe he's just weighing it up whether he wants to give that option. But, you know, he did just go to hit face and banking on that Chow. So
there's actually reason here to just play the Ice Barrier. Get the Ice Block out already. So because if you play the Arcane Intellect this turn, you can draw the secrets, right? But you have 100% chance to get Ice Block out already and build up the armor too. He goes for the Acolyte of Pain instead.
Yeah, on this board, it's supposed to get 2 draws, which is what you want from your mm-hmm. Acolyte. Like, normally you save it just because so you can ping it. But if he starts drawing cards with Arcane Intellect, he might actually put himself in the position where he doesn't want to draw any more cards.
That's what I wanted to say, that the Priest can abuse the Acolyte of Pain, right? It can be healed back. And if
That's actually true.
So I'm really interested how this will pan out, because next turn, if Moody would like to go for the Arcane Intellect, then I wouldn't be surprised if Kenny would heal the Acolyte of Pain and try to ping it as much as possible.
Yeah, that's actually one way you can win this matchup. Like, Freeze Mage is pretty bad against Fatigue. Mm-hmm. Like, your secrets don't get popped, and your Ice Block, you're sitting with your second Ice Block in hand, and it doesn't get popped and you die from fatigue. So maybe Priest is not really the deck you want to start fatiguing Freeze Mage with, but you have to find a way to win somehow.
Yep. So he's going to just go for a pretty, just a steady turn, just trade off the Scientist and heal up and let the Mage decide what to do with this Arcane Intellect as the secret does get pulled from the Scientist. And we can see that it is Ice Block purely because the barrier is playable, right?
So there was an attack after the secret was popped. I was thinking about, would you rather have the information, is it Ice Barrier or Ice Block already? Because it doesn't really matter right now if you know it this turn. Or would you rather leave your opponent with the option of not playing another ice barrier this turn, right? Because you could have attacked before the secret was popped, so then your opponent doesn't get the heal with the armor.
I think in this matchup it doesn't really matter because the priest deck is so slow that the ice barriers don't really do that much. But if you were playing an aggro deck, you would for sure attack first just because you wouldn't want your opponent to play the second ice barrier.
Double stack. Mm-hmm.
But there's also a factor that your zombie Chao would actually be more beneficial if he hits the armor and not the health.
Yeah, because right? It would only give 4 if it would die.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so the Luhog is going to come down now. And just again, add some more card draw. Yeah, so there's definitely a chance that, you know, the priest can actually just take advantage of all this card draw and really just push the cycle onto the mage, which in like a vacuum sounds bad, right? You know, like, oh, I'll make the mage draw more cards. Like, but it actually can be a problem, especially if this priest is, you know, built a bit heavily to go into maybe the late game, mm-hmm. especially with having True Heart already in hand. He can like bank that big heal quite early on, which is going to be a... You know, as you said earlier before, Powered, it's difficult for priests to heal a lot, but when the hero powers healing for 4, that definitely helps.
Yeah, for sure. Ooh, he's gonna Holy Nova here.
I'm kind of surprised by the Holy Nova here. I mean, usually you want to lead those Holy Novas after Alexstrasza, but when you can see that he has a Flash Heal and a Dossikar.
And I suppose other than like the +2 healing, which is what you play after Alexstrasza for, like you don't really get a good Holy Nova turn against Freeze Mage. It's like any AoE isn't normally that great because they're normally not filling the board up. So I don't mind it too much there. It still keeps these minions on board, pressuring. And to be fair, at this point, like Moody's going to have to kill this stuff at some point because you know it's still pushing damage.
Yeah,
and if you never kill Zombie Child, then it's never going to heal you for 5, right? So
yep.
You know, it's still putting some pressure on there, and he still has the Alcanai. To be able to, you know, push that extra 5 potentially for the Zombie Chow.
If I was in Kenny's shoes, when I was thinking about the last turn, I see that I have Justicar and I have a lot of damage with Akanai. Mm-hmm. It might actually be worth to Holy Nova there just to push more damage. Because you're actually getting close to popping him, which is kind of scary.
And ridiculous because your opponent shouldn't predict
exactly.
That.
Exactly.
Yeah, with the both Tero power, the Akanai, and the Flash Heal in hand, plus... If you really want to go wild, the Circle of Healing for the Zombie Child, but we are now going to see the Doomsayer go down with the Frost Nova, and...
It can be easily taken, right? Oh, no, wait, it's 1 mana off. Because I was thinking about Alcanai, Flash Heal, Hero Power.
Yeah, I mean, he can...
But it doesn't really make any sense.
He can Alcanai Circle... Oh, no, it's not enough, is it?
Well, he
would have to flash
Heal. I think Flash Heal might be too much of a commitment there.
But... You deal the 5 damage to your opponent's face, so he's at 13, right?
Yeah, true. So you trade in like the 5 damage from the Flash into the Doomsayer for 5 damage
but
from the Chao.
But then you throw out the Alcanai to die, and the Deathlord. Well, he will die anyway if you don't do anything.
It's a
really
one.
Tricky situation.
Yeah, and I think that it made it more tricky by the Harrison draw, because the Harrison's just like, he's pointless to a certain extent,
exactly.
So that draw's pretty much dead. If he drew, like, another Flash Heal, then suddenly it's like, oh, right, okay, I can burst this guy down. But a really tough turn here. I mean, his other option, really, is just to True Heart and just get that heal on board, but because he's already on 30 health, then he's throwing away a 6-3. Is he just going to pass?
Yeah, I like
okay,
this.
That's reasonable,
I think it's the best one. And hope that it maybe takes Alexstrasza. Another Doomsayer.
It is actually super bad for him. Because he can't develop the board again.
Yeah, that's actually sick.
Yeah,
was that like the best outcome of the like Emperor?
I think actually, yeah.
Because it just, you know, what's Kenny going to do
the
next
scientist
turn? Like,
would have been okay as well, I guess.
But this just locks out Kenny's next turn, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Unless you kill it, but he obviously didn't have an option to kill it, right?
Yeah.
So you're sure that there will be no answer. So now Moody has to ask himself how many cards do I hold?
He had eight cards when he drew, so I mean,
so now he has to play something. The mad
scientist. Is it
probably
worth just dropping the scientist?
Yeah,
yeah, because
okay,
if he kills the Doomsayer, you have the scientist. If he doesn't, well, the scientist dies and pulls the other secret out. So.
Yeah, that's actually pretty good. And
it won't pull the other secret because he already has the barrier in hand.
Well, he has the second barrier in the deck.
Oh yeah, we've not seen the first one yet, have we, of course.
Oh, he's dropping the barrier instead? I'm really surprised by that.
He might just be thinking that he doesn't have, like, if next turn, he draws like a Flame Strike or something, he doesn't really have a good card to drop. If he drops the Scientist now and gets a barrier, he can't play the barrier from his hand next turn.
Mm-hmm.
So he would have 10 cards in hand where he would maybe have to coin. And the coin is actually really important in this matchup because it is basically a fireball.
Yeah, just thinking about that you, if like that barrier will not get popped for a long time.
Yeah, for sure.
This is such a weird hand, right, for the freeze mage, because there are no minions or anything to interact with. His hand's actually getting full of stuff he doesn't need. Like, he could just drop Healbot and just take the heal now, which, you know, wouldn't be too bad. The Acolyte is starting to feel a bit dangerous because he's drawn a lot of cards this game. You know, same with the Arcane Intellect. Pyroblast isn't even castable yet. Frostbolt Face does nothing. He can't Blizzard in it. Well, he can Blizzard an empty board, but it's not going to do much. So, really, like, so it feels like a really wonky wonky turn. And he's actually 8 cards ahead. 12 versus 20.
I don't think it's that bad. You just developed the board that brings 2 decent minions, right? It's not a big problem. Your opponent might use, though, a couple Shadow Priests, but it's still not terrible.
Yeah.
Oh, that's clunky.
It's getting hard for Kenny here because he doesn't have any good plays. Like, normally as a priest you can like develop the board with some sticky minions which actually like survives against these like small minions of the of the freeze mage. But here we see you don't really want to play Arcanine.
How about Arcanine Circle and then Velen's Chosen on the Arcanine?
But it gets just destroyed by a single fireball.
Yeah, but the only thing is, like, if he gets killed by true. It's just that I kind of want to see these Velen's Chosens out of his hand, because at the moment they, you know, it's nothing you can do from hand without a minion on board, and the chance of these minions surviving a turn on their own, like if he played Harrison and then just passed or whatever, then, you know, getting the Velen's Chosen down on a turn you can attack with is going to be pretty difficult versus a freeze man.
He goes for
the
Velen's Chosen on the Harrison Jones.
7-8. I mean, I think I agree with this play. I think the other play was maybe just to play Justicar. It does die to the Healbot, but it's always going to die against Freeze Mage, so just getting the hero power out there.
Yeah, and then you're not worried about a single or two minions from Mage. So
yeah,
you
exactly, because you
heal
it,
and get guard the cards and get some sick combos, right? Ooh, Alexstrasza will change a lot because it's playable next turn.
And the thing is Alexstrasza into Pyro, and then he has Frostbolt, Ice Lance, Ice.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage.
He has double Frostbolt, Ice Lance, Ice Lance.
It's 14, 24. Like, normally you don't really want to play Alexstrasza against Priest until you know that you're going to kill them.
Yeah. Like, if there's, like, another Fireball in hand or something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
Or, you know, Emperor comes down and you can do something silly.
Because worse...
I like that, actually. I think it's the best outcome. What he can do... You don't want to develop the board, you don't want to play the Acolyte of Pain because you might overdraw. And your opponent has to be, kind of starting to wonder about those two minions that will damage your face, like, down for five damage each turn. Because the mage has such a big hand right now that has for sure a lot of burst. So you might die now without even the Alexstrasza. If you're being just burned out, then you have to play the Justicar, which is being traded by the board, so it's also not a problem. So it's a very uncomfortable situation for Kenny.
Yeah, I mean, you can play the Justicar here and basically heal up what he did, but when the Alexstrasza most likely is going to come down next turn, he's going to deal 5 extra damage over those 15, which is super important. It's actually probably going to win him the game just because he has those two minions on board.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think the only half redeeming factor is the next turn. If he plays Justicar now, he can actually Light Bomb, Heal, and Flesh Heal next turn. So to clear off the Alexstrasza if it comes down and still get a reasonable amount of healing, and then just has to focus on just not dying to the burst chain that the mage can develop.
Ooh, to play around Alexstrasza.
Yeah, I mean, at some point you think, oh, that's a good card.
Too bad he doesn't have the
good shout powder. Antonidas is definitely a good card. So,
I mean, now I'm pretty sure you just Alexstrasza here, right? Because you know, like, you can go next turn Antonidas, Coin, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, and get so many fireballs.
And get all of the fireballs.
All of the fireballs.
Yeah, and like you said earlier, this 5 damage is actually pretty huge. Like, so you Alexstrasza, push for additional 5, just straight away put the priest to 10.
That's 20 damage for 9 mana.
It's pretty good.
With the board control, of course, but sounds kind of sick, right?
Is there any way Kenny can survive here? He heals for 9 this turn. He's up at 19. He can't clear the board. But with that Antonitis draw, it's going to be really hard. I'm guessing he most likely plays another flash heal.
Yeah, I think you often just play two over just a one out.
And then maybe... what's the card called? The one that gives you three health? And
the Light of the Naru?
Light of the Naru. Yeah. So that's three extra, maybe.
The problem is the Antonidas will just fuel the mage beyond belief. And
yeah, and there's not even, like, obviously you said, like, the Antonidas can come down with Coin, Frostball, Ice Slam, so that's one already a lot of fireballs, but there's not even, like, a Shadow of Death or anything in hand to at least just stop it after that turn.
Disqualified. Oh, wow. He's going to save it. But then...
Yeah, well, he kills off his own Akanai, which is good, so he can actually heal next turn, and his Harrison survives. So this is probably just better than playing Light Bomb.
Do you think it was worth just slamming Balance on the Harrison there?
I mean, why not, right?
Yeah, because it's... You know, what else is going to happen next turn? Yeah. You can still pretty much play anything you want next turn. I suppose... and now he can't do, like, Light Bomb, Valens, and heal. So, yeah, an interesting one just because it dies to Frostbolt as well. But he just might think, well, if he's, you know, dumping a Frostbolt into Harrison, he's not putting one, you know, into the Priest itself.
But the question is, do you play Pyroblast or do you play Archmage this turn?
I think it's Archmage, Frostbolt phase, Iceland's phase, and Iceland's Harrison Jones with the Coin of Flash. Then you build up 7 damage, you have the Antonidas on board, you gain 4 fireballs, there's no way your Antonidas is being...
And you still have fireball, Frostbolt. Yeah. The next 15 next turn, so...
I actually don't think you care about the Harrison.
But it kills your Antonidas, right?
But you have, like... You just want to do damage.
You have, like,
to
a million
so
damage.
Many, yeah, you have so much damage that you just want to make sure that you can kill your opponent.
But you have 34 damage in your hand. What are you worrying about?
But this gives you lethal, though. Next turn.
Well, if your opponent wouldn't have the option to kill the Nidus, then you still have lethal because it's 5 damage on board.
But there's a lot of things that kill Antonidas anyways, like Entomb, Shadowward Death, where you actually don't kill him next turn because you wouldn't have done the extra 4 damage and 2 fireballs wouldn't have killed him. Like, I think all scenarios leads to a Freeze Mage victory.
Well, he has fireball and fireballs and fireball, which is 15. Right?
Well, he'll be
at 16, yeah.
But he knows he's dead here. He can only heal to 12. Do you have the
artifact? Oh my god, they're
yeah, and I feel like I've kind of cursed this guy because I was talking about
quit. How rage could all be harsh.
I was talking about how powerful his priest deck was yesterday, but you know, honestly, like Moody locking in that freeze mage, maybe this was a direct pick. Was Moody even playing freeze mage yesterday?
No, he wasn't.
I don't think he was.
He
right?
wasn't. For sure. He was playing Control Warrior, Druid, and Paladin yesterday.
Yeah. Okay. So he switched around his lineup a little bit, I would say. Taking a Freeze Mage is a huge swing when it comes to matchups, right?
And starting it out right away as well. When that's I'm guessing that is his pick against Priest. Then he must have had like a super good read that Kenny was gonna open that Priest. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because Kenny plays Druid. He plays, I guess Warlock is normally pretty bad against Freeze Mage, but he plays Druids. I would be super scared to open Freeze Mage.
Well, it depends what kind of Warlock it is. If it's Reno Jackson Warlock, right, then it might be hard for the Freeze Mage as well.
Yeah, exactly. So it's pretty ballsy, I think, to just open Freeze Mage.
I think also, like, maybe, you know, he took into account that after 3-0-ing multiple people yesterday, like, why wouldn't you start why wouldn't you start with your Priest? Like, that's one of those questions. Well, if he's consistently started Priest, mm-hmm. then maybe Kenny just thought, oh, you know, this worked yesterday, so why won't it work today?
Well, to be honest, I would probably just open with Druid, because it's Druid.
Yeah, I mean, I opened Druid a lot yesterday just because it doesn't have that many good matchups on paper, and it's just sometimes you just win because you draw well.
Yeah.
So I would have been really scared to open Freeze Mage, but he had the right read. Yep. Kenny did open Priest, and it worked out.
Paid off, and he had a really decent draw, especially with Alexstrasza before turn 9, because it kind of looked very slowly developing. It looked to be slowly developed during the game, but the Alexstrasza draw, right at the right time, at the correct timing, was changing the whole dynamic of the game.
And also the Doomsayer coming out of Deathlord. Effectively just gaining the mage an additional turn because the priest did nothing there. So
yeah, Time Walk.
It was pretty crazy.
There is also that 1 in 10 chance that Alexstrasza comes out and you just lose the game just because of that. Like,
is it that high? 1 to 10? There's 2 Healbots, 2 Mad Scientists, 2 Acolytes of Pain, Antonidas, and Alexstrasza. That's 8.
I suppose after so many turns, though, because you've drawn minions. Mm-hmm. Throughout the game. So
it's like around maybe a little bit higher chance.
So now we've got to imagine that Kenny's locked in the Druid here. It seems like the right thing to do against
We don't know what Warlock is. Like, I really think Reno Warlock, especially if you play like Bran Lotheb, is really good against Freeze Mage.
Or Bran Healbot.
Yeah.
It's like the second Reno Jackson, right?
But yeah, I would also pick Druid if I had it.
I think like this is definitely. I feel that a few people get a bit too much over how powerful Druid is versus Freeze Mage. Like, I'm pretty confident that Freeze Mage can take a win. You know, it's definitely not just game for the Druid, and it's that's straight off a game lost to Moody.
Yeah, but that's the thing in Hearthstone. You always talk about how a deck does in a percentage. Like, if you maybe think like, oh, I lost a game with Druid against Freeze Mage, and you're really sad, but when you talk to someone, like, yeah, my Druid is 65% against Freeze
Mage. Yeah,
that's
a really high percentage.
Yeah, that's a really high percentage. But it also means that 1 in 6, 1 in 5, you're actually going to lose the matchup.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, sometimes it happens in tournaments. Like, you're always that, like, oh, please don't happen. Not now.
Yeah, well I remember when Monk brought out all the stats a few months back of and it was, like, actual tournament match percentages of the matchups versus what everyone thought the percentages were. And obviously, like you said, Pad, like, you know, just the matchup doesn't just lead the game completely. You know, if that was the case, then no one would even bother. But yeah, looking at the hands, though, Moody's got a pretty good opening, I think. Just some early stuff, some cycle, and the Mad Scientists are just key. The Ice Block being in hand sucks a little bit, but you know, you still get some value off the Scientist.
Yeah, that's kind of really what you want to get with Freeze Mage against Druid. You want some early minions that can actually, like, start battling the Druid's minions just so he just can't attack face.
Yeah, because this is a matchup where you'd see, like, depending on how the board looks like, Druid with a claw charge. And, like, just really pressure. Whereas, as you said, Druid struggles to deal with multiple minions. And if he's focused on that, then he definitely isn't just building up the board for a lot of bursts later on.
It's actually pretty close to what you would do with Freeze Mage against aggro decks, where you really want your early minions. It's kind of the same goes true with Druid, just because in Druid you play a lot of spells that aren't that effective against Freeze Mage. Like, Swipe is pretty bad. Like, Force of Nature on its own doesn't really do anything. And if you can just take out the minions, like, maybe even Fireball, like a Druid of the Claw, often they don't have that much, like, good follow-up. Like,
yeah, you just want to slow the game down just enough that you can actually handle everything as it comes, as opposed to getting overwhelmed.
Ooh, he's gonna frost.
This is pretty good. I kind of like this because the way a Druid can whiff with an opening like this is if they, like, innovate Shredder, but then, I mean, we can see it as a shade, so, you know, he does have the curve, but sometimes people go, like, all in on that innovate because it just feels too good, but then when they have nothing follow-up, then, you know, again, it's just slowing the game down for a Druid.
He does have the shade, which is also a very good minion against Freeze Mage just because you can't use those removal spells on it, but it's also really important to attack before you get frozen and...
Yeah. Because the thing is, like, with turn 5 Frost Nova Doomsday, you're pretty much relying on a Keeper of the Grove, which we can see isn't there yet.
I kind of don't agree with.
Yeah, that's an interesting attack.
By the way, people tend to forget that Druid of the Claw is actually a beast.
That's actually true.
Yep.
It is.
So the Hyena might get buffed in the future.
Yeah, I mean, if there was armor on the Druid, I would like the trade, like going face a lot more. But now, like, you're never gonna win this matchup by just going face with spells and doing damage.
Most likely, it happens very rarely.
So, like, normally you have to have that Alexstrasza turn, and then you just basically want to clear his minions. So I don't really agree with that attack either.
Yeah, because it's not like in a lot of matchups you can sort of play chicken and be like, no, you're going to trade with my minion, but it's like...
But the druid's definitely like,
you're letting me attack face? Like, okay,
that's
fine.
That's the additional 2 damage to my combo, so it's now it's 16 instead. Action matters a lot, and you also give the opportunity to druids to get an innervate keeper if he really wants to do that. Well, probably not, because there's a Doomsayer somewhere in the deck too. But it's an option. There's like, it can get also killed by Living Runes, because that's in addition to Druids, right?
Yeah. So let's see if he's a good Druid player in top decks of Shredder.
That was interesting as well. So he guaranteed the draw of the barrier there, right? Because
yeah.
He played the Ice Block first. Do you think that's better or worse than cycling an additional card out of the deck?
I think it's worth it, because that barrier is actually free Healing Touch in this situation. Even better than Healing Touch, right? It'd be even better than Healing Healbot, because it gives you the armor, which is better than health, right? Usually.
Yeah, and if that 1 in 3 chance happens that you get the second Ice Block off of your Mad Scientist, you're just going to have a dead card in your hand for the whole entire game.
And also, Ice Block doesn't do anything
until
you're at 1-0 health, whatever. So, yeah, that's pretty good. But the Keep of the Grove in Kenny's hand is actually pretty key. It's like one of the key cards in the matchup, I think, because you just lock out that scary Doomsday turn, even though we can see that Moody
doesn't he doesn't have any good minions, though. If the Keeper was there and maybe had,
Tempo
a curve...
Tempo VGH power, don't
I would definitely play
VGH.
Yeah,
it's too early to worry
about
Keep.
I would for sure play BGH. You have to.
Yeah, I think it's too early. Like, if this is like turn 6 or 7, then like okay, maybe not, because you know Alex is coming soon. But the mage's on turn 4. It's going to be like 5 more turns till Alex comes out.
Like, I would probably attack with the Shade as well. You've seen one Frostbolt. If he decides that he wants to Frostbolt, you're one of your minions. Like, I wouldn't really care. Like, that's basically 7 damage you're taking off of maybe an Alex turn later, because now you don't have an ice lance trigger. But
well,
if
it would be additional 3 damage, that's threat on the board too, so your opponent is kind of locked into
and
clearing your minions.
And also with the combination of BGH on the board, then suddenly there's Frostbolt for the Shade, but then how are you dealing with the BGH, which is then going to continue to push.
And I agree with this as well. Just playing, instead of you could have maybe played Acolyte, but that's also just gonna die, but that's not the card you want to see here.
Definitely not. Push for damage, hero power.
Yeah, I think the only benefit to drawing that card is that it allows an easy hero power. There's no I kind of want to clear this off and then leave my guys alive. But he probably went just as happy to ignore that minion and let him do the trade.
But now I'm pretty sure he has to start attacking.
Yeah, this is good.
It's good because now even if there's a Frostbolt, he can't use ping on both of the minions, right?
It's going to be interesting to see what Moody does here.
No.
Fireball.
Well, that's an option. You fireball the Shade, get rid of it. Well, actually, you're doing the same thing by just pinging the Big Game Hunter. So you can develop Acolyte of Pain and ping Big Game Hunter, because the fireball can still kill the Shade of Nexomas next turn, right?
Yep.
It's just one damage difference.
That's true. And you've already kind of figured out that he probably doesn't have that many strong minions in his hand. Like, on turn 5, he decided to play Wild Growth Hero Power. I mean, it could be that he has like 7 drops in his hand also.
Yeah.
So he doesn't know that it's 2 spells and a Keeper.
You just imagine with things like a Shredder, Druid of the Claw, you just presume the Druid would favor those minions.
I don't like that, to be honest. I don't like this because you know that your opponent had a clunky hand, and now by playing the Doomsayer, he practically says, okay, I think you have an Ancient of Law, so you can't play it. Because then you can't really trade with it. But with there's an additional possibility of just having 2 Keepers and Force of Nature and other stuff, right? So
there's so many ways it's going to die. Even if this game would go on, he would always have this Keeper in his hand. But if there was another scenario where he doesn't draw Keeper, like Frost Nova, Doomsayer, he just draw Frost Nova. If he didn't have a Keeper, that's just the way you win. If you can Frost Nova, Doomsayer your board as Freeze Mage against Druid?
Yeah, they take so long to then gain that board back again that you normally can just close out the game pretty quickly, especially with Alex Strauss already in hand.
And imagine if Moody would actually just play Fireball on the Shadow Black Stormers, because Kenny drew a second Wild Growth in a row.
Yeah.
What do you do that turn?
Can't do anything.
Not a lot.
Do you play the Keeper?
You probably have to.
Right? You're pushed to play something on the board, because that's how Druid wins the game if your opponent is not on 14 life.
Yep. We do see that he drew the Emperor, though, which does speed up his hand a little bit. He does need to find a little bit more burst for Alexstrasza.
Yeah. Kind of interest. What do you think about the Acolyte over the Arcane Intellect there?
I think
you've got to presume Emperor's going to come down next turn, right?
Oh, he can't. He can't play the Emperor next turn unless he wants to use the Iceland as well.
Yeah, that's actually true, because he is gonna get popped then. But that's actually maybe actually a good play next turn. Emperor, Ice Lance, depending on, of course, what Kenny would do this turn.
Yeah. But how do you get rid of the Shade then? It gets out of range of Fireball pretty soon, and then you have to spend at least 6 mana to deal with it, right?
So this is
like the last turn when you can avoid dealing with the Shade of Naxxramas, in my opinion.
I think he's pretty happy with that draw. But it might still be better to Savage Roar, I'm not sure.
Like, take the damage while you can.
Yeah.
But you always have an option against Freezer to deter the damage, right? That's at least...
Yeah, I was just thinking that, like, your cards are pretty bad, so you might want to cycle the Wrath on a later turn and just take the Savage Roar damage now.
Mm-hmm. But it will be only 6 damage. I would like to use the Savage Roar at the moment when you can pop the block, right?
Yeah, it might actually be a lot better to just play Wrath there. You do have the Wild Growth to cycle one more card, so...
Yeah, this is kind of a rough turn though, because even like Fireball on the 6/6 is cool, because you know you remove the big threat. There still is your Drake in a 2/4, and you know when you talk about cards like Savage Roar, then it's just going to be so much extra damage.
I think
it's Mad Scientist Arcane Interlink. Sorry, Mad Scientist Frost Nova ping the Shade.
If you're gonna Frost Nova this turn, I think you have to play the Ice Lance on the 6/6 though.
Well, if you do the Frost Nova.
You can Ice Lance next
it,
turn.
Then you can still Fireball it next turn, right? You have 8 mana, so you can squeeze Fireball.
But you're doing 2 less damage for basically 3 less mana.
Okay, good point.
When the Ice Lance comes down on the Azure Drake, just to stem the tide, I suppose, and hope he can just survive that little bit longer.
The problem is that now your hand doesn't have a win condition, because the Alexstrasza is like, yeah, I will just deal the damage and sit here awkwardly.
So he's gonna pop him this turn, right?
Because he wants to silence his own minion, then play Savage Roar. So that's 6, 12, no, that's 13 damage. And
he can
swipe
yeah, face. No, it's not.
No, it's
he
not.
Can't pop him.
He can't pop it. No. Wait, first
with
swipe,
Roar?
It's 5 damage. 9, 11. Wait, what would you...
I mean,
not exactly sure. I would use the keeper in this situation because the keeper has such a big value when you can silence your own minion.
Yeah.
Right. You can silence your own minion or the Doomsayer. Those are the two targets. Like the Mad Scientist, in this scenario, if you build up the board, the Ice Barrier doesn't really matter.
I mean, it's definitely an interesting turn. We know that the Mad Scientist actually wouldn't have done anything, right?
Because
he's already played one Ice Barrier, or maybe that was last game.
Yeah, he played one.
Yeah, one.
Okay, so he wouldn't have done anything this game, but he was maybe thinking that like the second Ice Barrier would be bad for him. I don't know. I think I would have liked to have seen a swipe face instead.
It's 5 damage.
Yeah, exactly.
And 2 damage, you kill the Mad Scientist, and basically...
And you keep your keeper in your hand.
Yes. So you gain additional damage, because after a Frost Nova, or after a... What else? After the second Doomsayer, right? You can use the keeper for maximizing damage.
Yep.
Yeah, and every turn that happens here for Moody, it just gets that little bit worse, I feel. He drew into Pyro and the Thanos, but I just feel that they don't really, other than Thanos cycling, they don't really do too much on this board in terms of controlling, because now he only really has Ice Lance to stop anything happening. I'm guessing you just prop the block here, right?
You can pop at 1 as well, which is super nice for you.
And you have Swipe.
Exactly.
Yep.
So you have, for sure, an option to finish him off next turn or pop the block again.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I don't think you care about the Blood Mage Thanos here. So, I think it's pretty easy for Signature Savage.
Yeah, because you're not going to... If there's Flame Strike, well, you die anyway. The spell power does nothing, right? And then they kind of need to do Alexstrasza or something to be able to survive. So that's going to be mana spent. So yeah, I like just ignoring this, put him to 1. And then see what happens this turn. And like, this is looking pretty grim for Moody.
Even assert dominance by breaking the windows.
And it's also a thing where it kind of makes that your opponent really can't play Alex on your face. At least this turn. You give yourself a turn where, okay, I know he can't Alexstrasza me. And I know if he plays a secret and doesn't heal, he just drew Healbot, which is probably one of the best draws he could have found. But is it enough? I don't think so.
Well, it's 14 health.
He can Ice Lance the Azure Drake.
You need to play Ice Barrier, you need to play Healbot, and then you need to play the Ice Lance. Yeah, I agree with
you. So that's 9 plus 8.
Well, you could... 17. Would it change anything if you sacrifice for a draw? I mean, to sacrifice the Thalnos for a draw? Is there anything that could have changed your way of thinking?
Maybe a Frost Nova? You go Frost Nova?
Yeah,
I used to. No, then I think this is just the best play.
But I don't see an easy way out of this situation.
And also, with all the sort of not amazing card draws that Kenny's had, you know, I was just going to say, he's got to draw into something pretty impactful. We've not seen any Druid of the Claws. We've not seen Ancient Laws till now, so even the Shade's pretty okay.
Now the swipe will make a huge difference, because it gets you an option to clear all the minions, still have your own keepers of all without being threatened by the minions or opponents, so it makes a huge deal. Because you can use your hero power to kill the hero.
I think I would rather see a... I think I would like to play the Shade here. Or you just hero power face and trade with your minion. The armor is... okay,
you have Ancient of Law, right? And if your opponent plays Alexstrasza, then you have 8 damage on board anyway.
Yes. So he decides to do it. I like this a bit more. Like, every AoE is already bad for you.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't really matter.
No Ice Block.
But you can go Emperor, Frost Nova. That's pretty decent.
It's true.
I think it's probably the only play, right?
You could go Fireball the Azure Drake and ping off the 2-1 as well. But that just that means that your opponent can develop on a board where you don't have anything.
Yeah.
So I would definitely like to see an Emperor here.
Yeah, I think it's the only way he's got any chance of actually winning this game as opposed to just surviving a bit longer.
He didn't draw a single Blizzard and a single Flamestruck yet, right? I mean, he probably plays on one Flamestruck, but he should
normally
be
two
playing
Blizzard,
Blizzard and a Blizzard and a Hunt of Fame, right?
So at the moment, those Emperor reductions don't do too much. They make, you know, you can Alex King, I guess, but they don't have a mega impact until he maybe draws out.
That's the draw you want right here.
Yep. And now Blizzard is not playable unless...
It's in your hand.
Yes.
And that's might be what he's thinking here. He might be a little bit scared because Blizzard is actually one way where Moody actually wins this game.
Yeah.
Might win this game.
Yeah.
The Lothar could come down. Let's see.
And that closes out the game, right?
Yeah.
Well,
another
chance.
I spoke too soon.
But it doesn't change anything in the long run, right?
No. He can play Ice Block, ping off the 2-1.
Kill the 4-4.
The Ice Block's always going to get popped. And then
looks
he's
horrible.
Like he's always gonna have enough damage to kill you from 15, right? Is there any draw you can find? He's played both Ice Lances.
If he survives this turn, then draws Blizzard.
I bring life.
Oh, okay.
Actually, I like this.
To kill the Azure Drake because it's a spell power, so this swipe to use on 5, second swipe. No, that makes some difference.
I think you should kill the Azure Drake because, like, does the one damage matter that much on 20 health? Plus, you get the extra, you know, the extra tap from the Emperor.
You know, you're in really bad shape when you have to Alexstrasza yourself against
that's
Druid.
Lethal, right?
8,
12. Double charge.
It's exactly
lethal.
Wow.
Exactly. So the one damage from the Azure Drake was actually lethal.
Yep.
Well.
Yeah, there we go.
It was looking grim anyway. for sure.
He held on for so long though. Like that game was actually every single turn. Oh yeah, it's just gonna be over. And it's like, oh no, one more turn, which is what Freeze Mage does, I guess.
Well, the start was really harsh for Kenny. He was kind of pushed to use Big Game Hunter with no real effect. Then back to back draw of Wild Growth that didn't really develop anything. Fortunately for him, no Blizzard allowed him to develop the board without losing the minions, right? They were only frozen and they didn't get damage, so he can still build up the board turn after turn.
I definitely think there were definitely routes where Moody could have won this game. Like if he fireballed the shade. I think he would have won this game. Like there's no way for him knowing that Kenny doesn't have minions in his hand. But in the scenario where he does fireball, I'm pretty sure he just wins the game.
But there was no other way to deal with the shade unless you fireball it, right? You didn't have the Blizzard, you didn't have the Doomsayer for Snova.
You would have had to draw into it.
Yeah, so...
And especially the turn before as well, when he did the sort of plain Doomsayer and then drew into Frost Nova, like that must have felt a little bit rough, because normally you want to combo those together, of course.
Yeah, it was kind of like everything kind of went in Kenny's favor in the way Moody played the game. He played a Doomsayer on an empty board against a 5-5 where Kenny has no play other than Keeper. And it's like, yes, he played Doomsayer. I can actually play my Keeper as a value minion now. Yeah.
And how much damage did the Keeper actually do? A lot.
Yeah, it was on the board. Yeah, it died the last turn.
Yeah, so that's 8 damage, right?
Yeah.
Because it was turn 5 or 6, if I remember correctly, for the Keeper.
I think it was turn 4, actually.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
But wasn't there a Wild Growth before that?
No, he got Wild Growth after, I think, because he played Doomsayer Ping.
The turn before he couldn't Frost Nova Doomsayer,
so he played it on... It could have been his turn 5, I guess, because I don't know who had coin.
Yeah, it was a really crazy game, and now it's going to be 1-1 with the Druid versus... Protect the
wild. Ooh. Double Innervate opener. Now, do you keep the low tap in this case? Wait, what is that?
Yeah, that's not Rogue or Warrior.
Yeah, I think
is that Paladin?
It might be Deathrattle Rogue.
Yeah.
So for those of you who can't see, Lothar just did a cheeky grin whilst he said that. So not the most serious statement I've ever heard from you.
I mean, from those cards, I'm guessing it's Paladin or maybe Zoo.
Yeah, I think it's Paladin.
Well, Warrior with Hunted Creepers would be something new.
That would be definitely something I would like to see.
I don't think it has synergy at all
with
the class. But
looking at Kenny's opening hand, what do you do, guys? Like, double innovate Lothar, because Lothar is not the best card to innovate early on, although it is still a 5-5.
I think it depends what class
you're playing. Yeah, exactly. That's what it depends if it's Zoo, if it's Paladin. Against Paladin, I kind of like Lothar just because there are a lot of spells that are really good against Druid, but that's on turn 4, though.
Could lock out those turn 1 secrets.
Yeah, against Zoo, I don't really like Lothar.
It is Paladin, right? Wait, is Paladin?
Secret Keeper.
Oh, okay. Well,
so did Kenny keep the whole hand there?
He did.
Yeah.
So you go for the low tap turn 1.
I'm pretty sure. I mean, you kept it, so.
Yeah, you can't not.
And
right?
There's a coin. Your opponent can't play the coin on turn 1 even if he would like to. Did you see Moody's face? I was like.
He's like, Druid things.
Yeah. He rolled over his eyes like.
You know what's crazy as well? Like, the Wrath is actually super important here because he can use it to cycle. Because, one of the problems of doing a play like this is the Druid is like, well, look at his hand, right? Yeah. He has one card. So if this Lothar doesn't, you know, it gets under control a little bit by the Paladin, you know, he can be really in a struggle as well, especially because Moody's got a good opening hand overall.
Yeah, it's all about now that the Lothar needs to attack face.
Yeah, that's the thing I was going to say. Like, he's going to play Secret Keeper here, and you're going to be in kind of an awkward position because you just innervated Lothar. You don't want to start trading with a 5-5 you played on turn 1.
That's
you want to go face. Yeah, you want to go face.
So you bank on that Lothar dealing damage, and now you have to top deck or have in hand already an answer to every single minion that opponent will play. If you can keep up with that, well, that kind of sucks. But if you can keep up on just dealing with the board while the Lothar will deal damage, then you finish off your opponent with a single Force of Nature on turn 6, because it might actually happen. Or just finish up with a swipe, and that's it.
Yeah, this is kind of rough, though. So you can either Wrath.
Oh!
Ah!
No!
That's how scary Secret Keeper is, guys. It just has to die.
I mean, he must be thinking he needs this Wrathless cycle. That's like the only thing he could be thinking.
Was there ever a play of just like
I would have
Wrath
for
one?
Three. I
would
have.
Oh, would you have just
three.
Killed it?
Yeah,
okay.
I would just instantly kill it.
Just go face.
But look, you have to think about it. Wrath, in this situation, deals 3 damage to the minion, 5 damage to the face. Is that a good deal? Yeah, it is. Yeah. Let's go for it. Like you have, now your deck is the only cards that are bad in your deck are Wild Growths, and that's about it. And it's not even that bad when you have it Wild Growth, because it gets you close to the Ancient of Law.
Yep.
And you can still push for damage. Imagine now the Paladin being already on 20. There's actually quite a difference. Because now you can't really play, you can't really trade with the Haunted Creeper, so you just need to build up the board and deal damage.
I agree with this play.
Yeah.
Why? Because
just
you don't have a swipe. That kind of bluffs the swipe, but your opponent will not fall into that.
I mean, there are so many bad things for you here. Like, Blessings would just lose you the game. At least you trade off with the minion that's... I mean, it's only 1 damage, right?
But the damage, when you count, like, everything that was happening in this game, there's already 6 damage that was forfeited.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree that he should have gone face the first, and I would have put you on a such, like, different path, I think.
Yeah.
6 damage. Paladin at 18. And the board will still look the same.
5 damage. Because he hero powered face. Last turn we
have
played.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so 5 damage. So at 19. So one more attack from Lotep, and you put your opponent at lethal range with a combo at some point during the game. When your opponent still is on the back foot, so he needs to clear every single threat that the Druid is playing on the board.
Well, that's kind of funny as well. Is like, we're probably going to see it now, but like, Wrath. It isn't going to have a huge impact. He can remove the 3-3 or the 3-4, so it's going to be good. So it depends on what he drew as well, because then if he drew like into a Shredder or something, or you know, maybe even a Shade, then potentially playing the minions better, so then Wrath gets the
lead.
Yes. I agree with you, Porter. Like, the aggressive route should have been the stance of the Druid, like, from the beginning of the game.
Even if, in my mind, I was thinking, okay, I need to trade with the Secret Keeper, because that's kind of what I was thinking first. Like, do I want a Wrath? But in the end, I probably would have gone face. But now I just drew Force of Nature. And if I go face with my Lotep, it's guaranteed. There's no way he's going to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, he's going to take 10 extra damage. He's on 13. You just drew Force of Nature.
Yeah, I agree. Like, the aggressive stance, like, the only way you can trade with your minion when you innovate something really big on turn 1, turn 2 is because your minion has huge amount of HP or has a death rattle effect and you want to take advantage of that, because otherwise a minion like Lotep is just really good at pressuring your opponent. But it dies if it starts to trade, then you're presented usually by a 2-1 deal, and that's about it. But you have to take into account you spend 2 more cards to trade Lotep, so having the damage here. As you said, if you would attack face, the Paladin player would have been pushed to trade into the Lotep anyway.
Because the Paladin can't exactly race.
Yeah.
You know, like, he's not going to just be like, okay, well, if you're going face, then my minions will outvalue yours in the long run. That doesn't normally work when you've played a 5-5 on turn 1. So, that's kind of interesting.
At least he top decked something.
Yeah, well, that's that's true. But 15 damage lost in the process.
Yep. And he's on 3, and then Force of Nature would have been lethal last turn. Or next turn, I mean.
Well, that would have been a Belcher.
That would have been a pretty good draw.
But but even though there's a Belcher, that would still play, because your opponent has no way of healing himself. Does he play Lay on Hands? I bet he doesn't.
Yeah.
So, what are the ways of healing a Paladin? True Silver Champion? That's about it.
Yeah.
But you're still in range of a Hero Power swipe, or the Keeper actually just pushes for damage for the additional phase damage, right?
I mean, it would be interesting to ask...
No, second time, Haina.
To ask Kenny what he's thinking in this game. Like, like when you keep innervate Lotep in your opening hand, like, just in my mind right there is, okay, I'm going to be super aggressive.
Yeah.
Like,
you just decided the game there and then, right?
Well, now it's getting rough. It's getting rough for Kenny because his hand sucks in this situation. If only the Trans World Beast.
He does have Ancient of Lore.
Yeah, I mean, Ancient of Lore's gonna, you know, like, very much even this back up again once he gets in. He's still got a Paladin under a good amount of pressure. It's just this Ancient of Lore really needs to pull something like either, you know, like, more combo pieces doesn't really matter so much now he's used Force of Nature. But, you know, maybe like the Druid of the Claws and things like that to really just put some more board presence.
Yeah, I think he needs to find the second combo to ever win this game. And it's, I mean, he's probably on like 20 cards or something like that, so it's very unlikely that he does. And that's kind of the position he put himself in when he kept the cards he did and he played them as well, like leaving him with a single card in his hand and then started trading. Like, you just leave yourself in a bad position where Paladin has a lot of sticky creatures. You play Creeper, you play Belcher, play Shredder. Like,
it's just the fact that you've innovated out 5/5 to trade with a 1/2.
Yeah, in the end,
like, that's. I mean, you know, the Paladin's just winning that straight away.
Yeah, in the end, you are gonna get outvalued by.
Yep.
When you're drawing one card per turn, where you only have one card in your hand.
Yep.
Like, the chance of drawing, like, super good minions on curve, which was from turn 3, where you only have 2 minions, mm-hmm. turn 4, where you only have 4 keepers aren't really that good.
No, it's not terrible.
Yeah,
right?
It would have been better than what he had, but...
I mean, Paladin is still not out of the woods yet, right? Because
sure.
there's 16 damage, so 2 turns of hero powering and you end up all being killed by the combo. I'm not surprised that he plays the keeper, the low tip right now, even though it's not turn 9. Because you just need the pressure to do it now as soon as possible.
It was interesting whether I was half thinking about Kokama and Redemption. Because with a Shredder and a Creeper down, like, the value from Redemption is quite high. The Kokama might hit the Shredder, which means you can trade into the Ancient of Lore and still stay alive. But you're right, you know, the low tip just locks down quite
well. I mean, he's going to play Azure Drake Swipe next turn.
Did he just not play as your Drake?
Yeah.
I would have still played it
because you can just Wrath.
And you get one card closer to a Force of Nature.
Yep.
Like, and maybe a better play next turn.
Yep. Who am I? Why would you not play?
Well, the only reason why he's not playing that is because he wants to bank on the Azure Drake with the swipe next turn and just kill the board anyway. But he is getting in process 4 more damage and that's basically it. But your opponent... I don't know. Your opponent is just has a wide open road to develop the board.
Yeah.
There's no reason not to play anything that you have in hand.
I was gonna say that what's good for Kenny this game is that Moody hasn't drawn into his big stuff, but then he just top decks Tyrion, like, perfectly when he needed it. Oh, mysterious.
Yeah. They're as powerful as each other,
really,
right?
Matter. Yeah. They're both really good.
Yeah.
Some might argue that actually Challenger is better than Tyrion. Which is kind of ridiculous when you think about it.
For that card, you can use 2 of in your deck. But yeah, even like Coghammer is really strong, and the fact that he's not even needed to play it yet, but when he does, it's just another hurdle for the Druid to get over, and suddenly, like, combos suddenly looking harder and harder to pull off this in this game. Mm-hmm.
So how does this actually work? I'm not sure. I mean, you're always going to Azure Drake Swipe here, right? But does the Lotheb spawn off Redemption, or is it the first minion still?
I would not bet my life on it, but I'm almost 100% sure that the Lotheb will get back because it's the first target from the start.
Yeah, I think that's right, I agree. Because the 4 damage sort of hits first, right?
And animation also, you know, kind of shows it. But, you know, the weird stuff can happen in Hearthstone. Yeah. So we'll have to see, but it actually doesn't work.
Nope.
It's the first minion. Well, actually,
we're such
that's not the first minion, though. Or the Creeper, did he?
No, but the Creeper was spawning minions, the Spectre spawning minions.
Oh, he traded in with the Shredder first. Okay, so it was the first minion.
Oh.
But it's good to know, because that kind of puts you out of the question, like, should I do it or not? That was a really important thing. Imagine if that would be a 6/2 minion.
And Moody's got a tough choice now as to whether he plays the Golden Cockhammer or the non-Golden Cockhammer.
Well, you can play both.
It's also, where do you want the Cockhammer to land?
You can play first, the one, right? Because I think you
I think you value. I think you actually want it on the 2/2.
You can play.
So you then you would play it first.
Let's look at this from this perspective. We play the hammer first. We see when it lands. If it lands on the turn 7, I probably will go face anyway, right?
Yeah.
But you can also then attack with the Cockhammer first, play the second Cockhammer to get a 66% chance to get a second taunt.
Yeah, I think I like playing the second Cockhammer.
Yeah. Wow, that's really aggressive. I mean...
Oh, I definitely play the second one. Oh, okay.
BGH? Nope. So you have two more draws for BGH?
Man, I don't know. I'm still thinking about the second Cockhammer.
Yeah,
right
yeah.
Now.
At this point, that second Cockhammer is never going to get played.
He's maybe thinking that it's pretty unlikely that he kills me this turn, and I maybe need a taunt for the combo next turn.
But how does he clear two taunts this turn if it doesn't land on the 1070?
And you don't have the Azure Drake, because I would probably kill the Azure Drake. A second swipe. Oh,
that was a big misplay. He didn't kill the 2-2.
Yeah. I would have definitely killed it too. I was sure that he's actually aiming at it.
Yeah, like the only way you win this game is if you top deck. Keeper doesn't really win you the game either, but you need to top deck BGH, I think. Yeah. That was the only out you have here.
Yeah.
So then obviously the Divine Shield does nothing because BGH
kills actually, if you did it on the 2-2, you could play Keeper Savage Roar.
Yes, and kill both minions.
Like now, he kills himself. Okay. It's Noble Sack. Oh, I thought it was Avenge. But he's dead anyway.
Yeah.
It's exactly fine.
Yep.
So, how different would this game have been if he got very, very aggressive with that Lothar at the start?
It would have been over after 5 minutes.
It would have been a win. Like, I can't see a way where Moody would have won this game if he just went face with the Lothar.
I agree. Like, Lothar turn one, let's say you just stare against a Druid, like, this is the way you want your opponent to play when he innervates Lothar turn one. Please just trade with my minions. Please give me the opportunity to play a taunt minion every single turn till it dies. Because I'm okay with trading 3 minions for Lothar with 2 innervates. It's completely fine.
He did have the Keeper in his hand, though, right?
No. He got it from the ref.
No, the Keeper of the Paladin Keeper.
Oh, the Keeper of Ulduman.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So because he coined it on one of his minions. So instead, he could have Keepered the Lothab on an earlier turn where he probably wouldn't have done as much damage as we're thinking. So Moody might have actually won this game either way.
I don't think that was an option because we would have talked about it. That was the turn when...
that's the correct approach to have. If we didn't see it...
I mean...
I'm just trying to think back. Because I know he played a Creeper and then he Keepered one of the 1-1s.
After the trade from the Haunted Creeper.
Yeah, exactly.
But he played a Palter Shredder on turn 4, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, because he coined on 3 a Keeper. So it's kind of weird that we didn't think about it before because he could have just keepered the Lothab instead.
But it would be still a lot of damage coming from the Lothab.
Yeah,
anyway,
still
if it would
damage.
Be aggressive stance.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So
for sure.
Probably the Force of Nature would finish off the game anyway. Because after you see the Belcher, probably just keep the Force of Nature, wait for the Savage Roar, deal with the Belcher with other means because you will probably get the Swipe at some point, the Wrath. Trading with a minion hero power is still fine. You just need to get your opponent to 12 HP. That's against the Paladin. I think 12 is the sweet point because you play around Noble Sacrifice.
Yeah.
I even think like this whole like game just goes back from the first point where in Kenny's mind he's obviously trading with this Lothab.
Mm-hmm.
Like, then why would you keep innervate Lothab?
Yeah, because you could just cycle and draw better cards to
like
do that
could have,
with.
You could have had, like, you could have cycled away Lothab and maybe got, like, a Druid of the Claw or something, like, or a minion you could have innervated out, like, and kept a second innervate for maybe the
yeah, like a Shredder
War.
Or something where just you just throw one.
Yeah, so just play kind of a normal game.
Well, you have Dr. Boom and Tune in hand. Do you keep it?
I don't think Paladin can play ramp cards.
Yeah, but
that well, but
an example when I'm going second, I always keep Mysterious Challenger. Always.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Against Zoo, it's kind of... But I guess he doesn't know which Warlock it is, though. I mean, Mysterious Challenger is one of the most important cards when you're playing against Reno.
Mm-hmm.
But against Zoo, it maybe not be that good.
Wow, but this
Yeah, that looked like a pretty nice opening.
I'm actually surprised he didn't keep the Redemption. I think I almost always keep Redemption if I have Knife Trickle in my hand.
It depends.
Do you keep it with Minibot as well? Against.
Huh?
Would you keep Redemption with Minibot as well?
No, I think just against Warlock, it's just so often your Knife Trickle just doesn't do that much. If you have the Redemption then play it, then you can almost always get three juggles off the muster afterwards. Or he's playing two Coghammer as well. So you just get your 3-1 back, and then you can Coghammer and keep alive an extra turn.
That's true.
Because now he didn't top deck at 2-drop. I mean, it's pretty likely when you mulligan 3 cards, you're going to get a second 2-drop or a 1-drop, which you could have played. Mm. But now his curve is really awkward.
Yep.
But he's just going with the Knife Juggler, hoping maybe to top deck a 1 next turn.
Yeah, and also Knife Juggler actually just charges the Voidwalker and still lives.
Yeah, but you count on your opponent not having an Abusive Surgeon and a Direwolf out for 3 hours.
Yeah. It's just been a bit risky, right? But with that hand, I think that was pretty reasonable, because otherwise he's...
It did work out. It's actually not that bad to play here.
Yeah, I'm just mean if that was drawn the turn before.
Yeah, actually
Competitive Spirit is really awesome here. We had a situation yesterday when a player, I think actually that was Moody. Yeah, that was Moody. He didn't play the Competitive Spirit turn 1.
Yeah.
And that would be perfect, because he had a Knife Juggler on turn 2, and it was very similar situation to here. So he would have taken advantage of the Massive Battle on turn 3, because the Knife Juggler would have definitely died, but he can also bluff with the Secret.
Yeah, because it wasn't even a Knife Juggler, was it? It was because he had no 2-drop, any hero powered.
Yeah,
because we were like, well, the Druid's going to kill the 1-1, right?
Yes,
you know, like,
yes.
You rely on that. But and then we saw that the Comp Spirit actually stayed
for
so long. It stayed in hand for like turn 4 or 5, which is like...
He hero powered turn 2, but even if the 1-1 wouldn't have been killed, you're so fine with getting a 2-2 against a Druid.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah, so we see the... do you think the Comp Spirit should have been played there then?
I
think that was worth more than the juggle, right?
I definitely think so. I mean, most likely the Voidwalker is going to trade into your Knife Juggler anyways. And
but
you're
then
almost
redemption, as you said, redemption
would
be a huge factor.
The thing is, like, he doesn't know which secret it is, even though it's not the why.
Wait, what?
Why
those
why?
Value trades, Powder?
He plays into a Masterful Battle to get the juggles on the 2/4.
It's not worth it. It's just not worth it.
I'm trying to just think whether, like, there's ever a play where Coghammer's okay. No. You leave the Divine Shielded Juggler.
Actually.
Because you can Coghammer into the 1-1 and then the Juggler's Divine Shielded, so how does the Warlock actually kill?
You have double muster.
Yeah, that's true.
Like,
that's one.
Okay, one is okay.
And you want to hit the new one.
The new one, yes. If you would hit the new one, then you could have completely wrecked the board.
Yeah.
This is why you shouldn't leave around a Knife Juggler, because you're leaving that to chance. You don't want to get it. You don't want to give an RNG chance to your opponent.
Just choose to trade into the Imgang boss, clear off for the 1-1, and just leave 1-1-1. Too many ones in that sentence on the board versus the 3 dudes.
Wow, that's not really what you want to see here.
Well,
just take Lepinome?
I guess.
Those coins.
They're all pretty bad. Like, you're never gonna, like, you've already, Relinquary Seeker is never gonna get procced.
Unless you get a 4 implosion.
Yeah, 4 implosion, maybe.
Yeah, but without it even in hand. Like, if you had implosion in hand, maybe there's a play for that, but Lepinome just seems too, like, just the best overall card.
You just go. This is so tough now. Like, he can just play Piloted Shredder here on an empty board and just have complete control. Or even play Mysterious Competitive.
I think it's just 2 hero powers and hero power.
Or hero power and 2 secrets, the Comp Spirit and the Avenge. I mean, to be
honest,
he has all the options in the world here.
Because
just face tank the Lepinome.
Face tank the Lepinome, play both secrets, hero power, you have 3 minions on board. If your opponent attacks into the secrets, then you might think about like the event and all the sacrifice, right? And you want to give your opponent that option. And if he kills one of the minions, you still get the Avenge and the Competitive Spirit at the same time, right?
I think I would have. I think I've always would have played the Shredder though, and then next turn do muster and then play the 2 secrets.
Mm-hmm. That's a valid point too.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is fine too.
Yeah, because on like all the choices seem pretty okay there, because like next turn now he can just shred a revenge, which
so
is pretty decent.
You're so far ahead that you have very good choices, and it's all like, if I do this, I'm still going to win. If I do this, I'm still going to win.
It's just picking whichever play you like more, right?
Yeah.
Which is more fancy for the broadcast, right?
Yeah, and I would have liked to seen the Shredder as well, just because it would have given you an option to play Coghammer next turn as well. If, like, say a big minion came out, then you can Coghammer and trade very effectively.
Ooh.
He's going to get punished.
Punished heavily.
I mean,
he has a bit of a smile and a nod there from Kenny going,
one mana, 5/5 minion. Yeah. Sounds good.
He does have two minions that are 3 health, though, which I guess is one positive thing.
It doesn't really matter because
the weapon
kills
one.
And the follow-up, like Shredder into Revenge, feels pretty good here, into the Challenger, and it's just, I feel like it's just already snowballing. I mean, even a couple of turns ago, but this is just progressively snowballing into out of control.
And then if you ever feel threatened, you do have Coghammer to just set up a taunt. Like,
why not Coghammer right now? Coghammer,
you can, for sure.
And probably Avenge?
Yeah. I think it's similar to last turn, where like you just pick whatever play you just
feel
like, and
both
it's fine.
Plays make you put
but
you
I
so
I would
hard.
Actually attack first with the weapon from Muscle Battle. Because now he has to sacrifice...
It's the same thing.
No, but you sacrifice
one
durability. You
sacrifice
one
charge.
Yeah.
But it's... like, in Moody's head, like, if you're, like, this is his kind of... like, he hasn't been that far in the tournament. Like, you're always just like, oh, I have one more game. I'm so far ahead. Like, I can do whatever I want. Like,
that's not the proper mindset.
No, it's not. But it's all
for the right?
It is not, for sure. But it's
difficult
it's
not
very,
to do, right?
It's like, very easy to come to that point.
Who am I? Yeah, and then things just progressively get more worse. Only 3 secrets pulled, but I think Moody's pretty okay with that, considering the value he got from the secrets he actually did draw.
Yeah.
I
do like that Moody's taking his time. He is thinking about his turns, even though he is so far ahead. Like I said, it's super easy to get into that mindset, but he's taking his time. He's
not even gonna concede, just straight up quit.
All the 4. That's harsh.
Yeah, there's actually no way out here, right?
No.
Just we can't really see the board properly, but with the secret, you know, one is get down or noble sacrifice. So, you know, there's so much damage represented on the board. There's still an Avenge, the Redemption. I don't even think Enhanced Mechano can pull this game back.
I would like to have seen, like to have a pulse monitor on Moody right now and just have it on the screen. Like, it would be like 200 beats per minute.
I really hate this card in the new Zeus.
Oh, really?
I don't like it either.
It's so clunky.
Do you just value consistency over something like this?
I always value consistency unless I'm playing combo deck. Because then the combo deck is all about cycling deck and getting the combo pieces. But when you play minion-based deck, you value consistent minions and not a wacky card that, first of all, is RNG. Second of all, relies on board state.
I think it's a win more card. And in Zoo, you don't really need a win more card. Like,
because you win by having more anyway.
Exactly. Like, it's just, I have 5 minions in play. I'm most likely ahead on this point because I'm playing Zoo. It doesn't really matter which deck I'm playing against. If I have 5 minions, I'm in a good spot, right?
Yep.
And then I just play this card, which, if I have 5 minions, it's amazing. But it just makes me win, like, a game where I'm 90% already.
Yep,
but here comes Moody.
He's
going to advance
here
into the top 8 for tomorrow. Congratulations.
Congratulations. Thank you. You're in the top 8. Now you have 2 points for the HTC and HCT and $1,000 in your pocket. So congratulations. Now we have to prepare for the next round. Right?
Yeah, thank you. I will.
And you are actually the second pair, so you probably have to watch the next game as well, right?
I'm going to study.
Pull the old notebook out. And
So
what can you tell us about the games? Anything interesting that was happening that caught your attention?
I knew his lineup from the first day, and it was really good against my first day lineup.
Okay.
And because of that, I thought he won't change his lineup, so I just countered him. And like I thought he won't bring something like Shaman or Face Hunter, because first day I had Druid and Control Warrior, so I pretty much Rogue and Freeze Mage should be good against what he does.
Yeah, so well, seems like a good idea to bring against Priest.
So
yeah.
out of interest, the opening, it's something we discussed, the opening Freeze Mage, you hit the Priest, which was really good for you.
Yeah.
Why did you open with Freeze Mage? Because did you not want to hold the Mage to deal with the Priest?
No, no, alright. So I put in, like, if I had his lineup, I would keep Druid for Freeze Mage. So if he opens Druid and he loses, then my Freeze Mage can 2-0 his decks. So based on that, I thought he won't open Druid because he wants to keep Druid for Freeze Mage. So I just enter Freeze Mage and take the first win, and then I have an advantage.
Yeah. Okay.
I like that.
Okay, good. What about the situation when you saw the Lotep on turn 1? I saw your reaction was like...
Druid things.
Know. Yeah. Well, it wasn't that bad because he didn't have a turn 2. And
he actually had a Wrath in the hand.
Yeah, but yeah.
So he could have killed the Secret Keeper and just go face.
Yeah. I'm not sure if maybe it was better, but yeah, I didn't like it very much. But I had a very very sticky hand with double creepers, shredders,
mm-hmm.
and I got pretty lucky with the challenger. And of course, he didn't have Big Game Hunter because if he did, it was game.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I guess that's it, and now we can. Prepare for the next match. Watch yeah, next
relax
notes.
A little bit.
Yeah. Well, not making notes. Noting every single card and seeing how your opponent will pick his first deck is very important. So you have to focus on that. That's for sure.
Yeah.
But congratulations again. You're advancing to the top 8, and now we'll be going to a break. Short break. So don't go anywhere, guys. This is the PGL Spring Tavern Tales 2016.